explore the wisdom of the revered Narada Bhakti Sutras, a cornerstone of Hindu devotion, with His Holiness Swami Jyotirmayananda. Experience 45 enlightening lessons on the essence of Bhakti Yoga. Discover the path to pure love for God and transcend the material world. Embrace the teachings that have guided devotees for centuries. Attain spiritual perfection through devotion. Prepare to understand the depths of divine love. Find your path to spiritual enlightenment. Trust in the sutras. Follow these instructions. Be blessed with devotion. And now, His Holiness Swami Jyotirmayananda.
Om Vasudeva Sutam Devam Kansa Chanura Mardanam Devaki Paramanandam Krishnam Vande Jagat Gurum. Om. Adorations to Lord Krishna, the preceptor of the universe, destroyer of the forces of darkness, and bestower of immortality. In Narada Bhakti Sutras, this is Sutra 35, Sage Narada presents different means and methods for promoting bhakti, devotion to God. Tattu Vishaya-Tyagat Sang-Tyagac Ca. That indeed is attained, that referring to bhakti, devotion to God, by renouncing objects as well as sangha with objects, attachment to objects. There are two directions for the mind. Vishaya Chintan, thinking of things that come within the range of senses, and Ishwar Chintan, mind moving on to God within you. Ishwar Chintan can take two aspects: Atmavichar and Bhagavat Chintan. Atmavichar, who am I? Leading to, I am Satchidananda. I am existence, knowledge, bliss, absolute. Aham Brahmasmi, I am Brahman. In this process, intellect takes the predominant part, the path of intellect. The other one is path of feeling. Mind turns towards Ishwara, God, who dwells in your heart along with your soul and who is constantly guiding the soul through the world process. The more the soul turns to God within, greater is its spontaneity of spiritual advancement. This relationship between soul and God is mysterious. On the part of the soul, there is always a need of self-effort. Greater the self-effort, greater the grace of God. Self-effort implies, according to your awareness of your personality, you develop an aspiration. May I become better? May I come close to God? May I attain liberation? And for that, you begin to practice sadhana in day-to-day life. While practicing sadhana, you have to always understand your self-effort is important. You should not go away advanced saying that I have surrendered to God. God wants me to wake up at 4, I wake. If he wants me to do meditation, I will meditate. But I do nothing now. So try to differentiate between what is within your capacity without contradicting that even the self-effort that you practice is sustained by God's grace. But the idea that is sustained by God's grace should not disturb your practical involvement. In other words, if you want to meditate, you have to take care of your health, go to sleep at a time when you can wake up early in the morning, feel refreshed. Many things. Allow your life to become more harmonious. Your sadhana should become rhythmic day by day. Things to be avoided should be avoided. All things have to be followed precisely. Never sit back and say, oh, enough of all. I just surrender. Yes, you can do that when you are sick and hospitalized. But as long as you have the ability to be angry and go after food without thinking, let God supply the food into the mouth, then self-effort, when it is a question of eating food, things that are closely related to your practical living, mind does not discuss about should it be self-effort, should it be grace. In other words, when you are hungry, you do not have that discussion in your mind. You simply go into the kitchen, put things together, eat. It is after when you are not hungry that you question, should I be doing that particular responsibility? Should I be handling that? Shouldn't God handle it? But what I want to tell you is that all practical realities you have to handle with the understanding that you are unable to handle because of God. Your practical duties should not be abandoned. In all detail, you are driving a car in the midst of so many other in rush hour. You can't sit back and say, now I surrender to God. You can do both. I surrender to God, but go on using all your intellect, all your ability. This must become easily graspable by the mind. Surrender is something that gives another dimension to your activity. It doesn't interrupt your activity. Only thing is your activities become more dexterous, more skilled, easy, spontaneous. Many difficult things you can handle in a simple way because you have your mental energy is not being wasted. The umbrella of surrender is supplying to your mind a kind of drizzle of nectar. Now, coming to the statement given in the sutra, Visaya-Tyagat Sang-Tyagac Ca. Tyaga is to abandon. Sangha is attachment. Attachment is a mental development. You can abandon objects literally, but that doesn't mean that you have removed attachment from your mind. Some objects that are gross, they need to be abandoned. Any inclination to tamasic style of life, drugs and bad associations, there you should not adopt that philosophy. After all, it's a mental. We can stay with all day. noisy crowd, and after mentally I'm quite calm, relaxed. That becomes deceptive way of thinking. The ideal is to understand the psychology of attachment. Why do people become attached to objects? And whatever object has become the basis of your attachment, your mind goes on thinking about that object. Turn your attention to the statement of Krishna in the Gita. Dhyayato vishayan punsa sangasteshu pajayate. As you go on thinking of objects, attachment to objects arises in your mind. Attachment has its root in your unconscious. Each time you have derived some type of happiness or some sense of comfort on the basis of an object, your mind has created a wish. May I have that more? May I have that more? Also understand, when we say object, it is not simple objects like chairs and tables or even human beings. Object refers to many things. It's vast. All things that come within the range of your mind on the basis of senses, they are all objects. For example, you are seated, relaxed, trying to meditate, but your mind is thinking of things that happened before, memory. You are thinking of objects. Or your mind is thinking of what will happen in future. Even in a spiritual way, what will I do when I become enlightened? All that is objects. The very movement in time and space, mind thinking in the terms of time and space, object. Another point. Suppose with a very religious feeling, you went to a pilgrimage center, went up into the Himalayas by the Ganges, and you felt exceedingly thrilled. Your mind has developed, now mind has developed an illusion that I have attained the greatest experience in my whole life, and it is there in the Himalayas at that address. So now you constantly long for going back. Suppose after 10 years you are able to go back. Your eyes don't see that much clear. Your body doesn't react to situations. And you feel you're miserable. What happened? All your expectations. That also is object. Happiness is not in the objects. That point the mind has to well understand well. But when you go on building up that concept, that when I met with a certain group of people, I was so happy. So let me invite them again. Or let me go to a certain place. Let me have a certain trip. And mind goes on longing for it. All this is a pursuit of objects. And your mind needs to have clear understanding. If you are happy, happiness comes from within. Promote sattva within yourself by meditation, by living your life, daily life, enriching yourself. Instead of being distracted, going here and going there, picking up little happiness here, little happiness there. Dil ke tukde hazar hue. Wherever there is happiness, you fall in love with that happiness. Your heart gets scattered in 1,000 places. And that leads you to a terrible situation. Your soul goes on after those places, from life to life. So instead of living with that sense that one day I'm going to certain place, one day I'm going to have what I like. And so your happiness is somewhere at a distance and you are trying to grab it. You must realize that it's extremely foolish, even if you are not spiritual. And clearer understanding, happiness can be attained any time, because it's a matter of your own heart. God abides in your heart. All the splendor and joy that you can perceive on this earth or in the entire universe is here and now. And it is that truth that must become fully established within your mind. Therefore, dismiss all expectations of what you are going to do, where you are going to enjoy. But your where and when are all sunk into your own heart. Here and now. Now let me follow, give you this statement. Dhyayato vishyan punsa sangaste shupajayat. If you constantly allow your mind to go on moving in countless areas, which that is what mind does in all people, sandasteshu pajayate, you go on creating attachment. One thing is not being stated, you go on creating also it. You waited for a long time to go to a certain place or meet a certain person with the idea that you will have the same type of happiness as you had before. And you went there and you didn't get it. So you in a state of frustration, you will always try to find someone to blame it. Hatred develops. With imagination, you can elaborate that point and understand how each time you are frustrated, the simple solution to how to handle frustration is point your finger to someone. And then go on building up another type of karma. Hating, and the result of hating is some negative karma. So, constant thought of object creates attachment and hatred. Impressions of raga dvesha enter your mind. Kamat krodho vijayate. And when your desire for object is obstructed, anger develops. Anger here refers to agitation in the mind. Suppose your desire is fulfilled. Any desire has two ways to go. Fulfillment or it's not fulfilled. If it is fulfilled, the Vedantic term is anger. Your mind is agitated. Deep within you don't believe it. Don't believe you deserve happiness. So mind becomes elated. The result of elation, you want something to help you, so immediately you invite people to share that elation. And to make the elation work better, make them all drunk. So no one asks the question, why are you so happy? You must realize, I'm just exaggerating it to beyond limits. Like, when you study something minutely, you have to magnify it. So as a result of agitation of the mind, krodhad bhavati sammoha, you don't see things with clear reason. There is delusion behind it. Sammoha smriti vransha. Moha requires subtle understanding. Moha is delusion. But it has two aspects. It looks like a tender love. And sometimes people try to secure that type of relationship to create more moha. But moha type of relationship is to secure weakness. If two persons are involved, each one is trying to see that the other one remains weaker. Of course, this is not understood. No one sincerely wants to hurt another. But moha is a kind of sickness. At that time, you don't realize that. Let me dramatize that moha. Patients who have lived in hospital clothes, and they have liked to chat each day. Now one day, one patient hears the other one, he's going to be released. Praise to him. Oh God. She has been the only comfort, she or he. That's an illustration of gross moha. Subtle moha is everywhere. A growing child, a mother loves to see the child close by. And now the mother were to develop that idea, the child has to be always with me. And then you go on telling scriptures to the child, look, a mother is 100 times greater than if you are close by, you will flourish. You will have all the 100 fathers' blessings on your head. This is the language of moha. In nature, in God's plan, moha is restricted automatically. Look at the birds. The mother bird tends to the young ones with all love. She can risk her life, goes far and wide to bring food, pours down the food into the beak with such precision that it doesn't prick the tender throat. But the same mother, in a while when the bird is ready to fly, starts kicking the baby until the young one starts flying. And when they start flying, they are no longer saying of good morning, good evening. They go their separate ways. Nature has planned that. In human level, you can modify. Your moha should become more and more profounder love. But amazing success can be gained if you develop philosophical, spiritual understanding that you are dealing with souls. So whatever you do to help anyone, whether it be child or friend or whomsoever, deep behind that process is love of God and serving God, worshipping God. If that comes into your inner feeling, then there is no moha. Moha diminishes, prem expands. And that, if that begins to develop, you become a true devotee of God. Because you look around yourself and don't see anything other than God. Siya Ram mein sab jag jani. Everywhere, every individual is indwelt by God. It is His presence that shines through the personalities of all. And your spirit of service expands. Sarve bhavantu sukhina. Now, coming back to the sequence, how it happens. You go on thinking of objects, become attached, gives your mind agitation. If the object of desire is not fulfilled, agitation creates delusion. When there is delusion, there is absence of memory. Smriti vranshat, not exactly absence, memory becomes interrupted. There is a constant awareness of what is good in divine plan. But that awareness continues if your intellect is not dominated by moha. Moha is like a mist, like a smoke. You forget what you are, what you ought to be, what is real pride, what is dignity. Mind forgets it. Going further, you forget spiritual experiences you had, spiritual insights. Smriti vranshat buddhi nasho. Intellect that is within you is no longer of any help to you. It's called buddhi nash. Your intellect has been destroyed, figuratively. And you will live in a house where electricity never comes in. That's a miserable existence. Buddhi rashat pralashyati. Buddhi is the one that which will give light to your own personality. The intellect. Without intellect, life is extremely dull, dark. Now, being a bhakta, a devotee, you try to reverse this process. Instead of thinking of objects, start thinking of what? What the reality that indwells all the objects. From a profounder point of view, given you the idea, you see so many things reflected in a lake. Now, if your attention is going towards things that are reflected, then it is Vishaya Chintan. Because those reflections come and go. But if your mind goes towards the lake itself, Ishwar Chintan. Because God enfolds the entire creation, just like reflections are enfolded by a lake. So you have two choices. If you are not advanced, then you are looking at reflected things. And these things move. They are constantly changing, transient. But the reality, lake-like presence of God, that is the reality. All things are only reflecting in it. If mind begins to go after that, that's Ishwar Chintan. Yajadap. Ishwar se laba lab bhara hua. The world is overfilled with God. So where else should the mind go? But this process is progressive. How to move your mind away from fleeting objects and allow your mind to penetrate the objects into the deepest level and become aware of one homogeneous, absolute presence of God. It's a progressive movement. As your mind becomes purified, you more and more you become aware that the world is not distracting you from your devotion. The world is nothing but expression of God through Maya. Therefore, day by day, whatsoever you do, your work can be saturated with an inner feeling that I am adoring God. If that happens, instead of developing Sangha, attachment to objects, now you are developing attachment to divine love. Sa paranurakti Ishware. Devotion is supreme attachment to God. Instead of being attached to objects, you become more and more attached to God. Where is He? Question doesn't arise. The entire universe is permeated. He is within your heart, and He is the underlying reality behind all that is. Whatever you handle, whatever you come into contact with, is permeated by the divine self, just like the reflections are permeated by a lake. So, if Ishwar Chintan becomes possible through your mind, and you become attached to God, in normal process, Sangat Sanjayate Kama, every attachment brings desire. Here, attachment to God brings aspiration. Aspiration for attaining communion with God, coming closer and closer to God. That aspiration draws you to satsanga, good association, guidance of guru and righteous conduct, all follow because of that particular aspiration. Instead of developing moha, you go on experiencing purity of love, a progressive revelation of what love is in reality. And no longer smriti vransha. Memory becomes intuitive, intuitional memory. First step of the intuitional memory is to understand you are a soul. This life and all things you have experienced in it is just a little drop in the context of having already lived through many lives. This is just little. This, however, doesn't diminish you. You begin to realize you are the sky. And every little situation that develops where you see the sky limited, like a little drop of the sky or like a little blue, that's unreal. That's not the reality. I am always the sky. I've never been a blue patch. That is called memory. Otherwise, another way of memory, I have never been happy. I have been always moving from life to life, led by karma. That's due to smriti vransh. The true memory that should have dawned upon your mind moves away. Fictitious memory rules your mind. And that's the cause of all stress, all agitations of the mind, all miseries of the world. And if you don't have that smriti vransh, buddhi, intellect blossoms. Intellect normally brings you indirect knowledge. But now intellect that is freed of the pressure of ego becomes intuitive. Like a little bird has now become a garuda. And with intuitional intellect, you attain enlightenment. Instead of pranashyati, if you are moving in the realm of karma, it's a kind of big destruction. You become absolutely free of all karma. therefore the ideal before you, to again and again let your mind turn to God. Allow your mind to think of God in so many ways, studying scriptures, thinking about how Rama acted with Shabari, how he bestowed his blessings in different contexts, according to your religion, according to your own faith. There are different levels. First level is ritualistic. Second level is more allegorical level, until your intellect begins to develop intuitional state. Visaya-Tyagat Sang-Tyagac Ca, Visayesu Visajjate, Ma Manusmara Tachittam, Mayeva Praviliyate. The statement from Bhagavat Puran. If you keep your mind engrossed in objects, then your mind stays stuck, conditioned. Allow your mind to become engrossed in God. Mam Anusmarachittam. Then mayeva praviliyate. The mind merges in God. When cloud becomes attached to the light of the sun, it goes on dazzling. And what happens to it? It remembers the sun more and more and more. And it gets thinner and thinner and thinner until it fades away. Mayeva. But if the cloud were to go on remembering anything other than the sun, the moisture goes on gathering it, and there is no end to it. Ram vilasu ram anuragi tajatva man jimi jana bada bhagi. Mind begins to enjoy the Tulsidas statement. Enjoy repetition of divine name. Anuraga develops. Anuraga means you become more and more attached. If today's practice of japa has given you some peace, you are longing for greater peace through japa next day. Your mind moves more and more in the process of being attached to that divine name. And all objects of the senses, the Vishaya Chintan becomes like Vaman Jimmy, vomited stuff. The stuff that you have been thinking of so many lives. And in each life you vomited it away. And yet you are going after it. With Bhagavat Chintan, your mind is encountering something new, refreshing. With Vishaya Chintan, you are encountering something old, decaying. But you realize this study is under controlled situation. Presented to the masses, they will be extremely upset. Next sutra, Avyavrita Bhajanat. Devotion is developed by uninterrupted worship. Turn your life into a stream of worship, and it should be uninterrupted. Binu hari bhajanna bhavatari yah siddhant apel. Bhajan is not done, you cannot cross over this ocean. When you cross over the ocean, if you know how to sing the divine name, how a stream of divine song were to flow in your heart, while it is flowing within your heart, you can swim. And you can easily cross over the ocean. But if you don't know how to sing the divine name, it is a joyful remembrance of God, that is bhajan. And the literal aspect is, you, Om Namah Shivaya is a mantra. But when you begin to sing it, Om Namah Shivaya, Om Namah Shivaya, Shivaya Namah, Om Namah Shivaya, bhajan. And when you sing stories of Rama and anything of particular aspect of Rama, Krishna, God, Jesus, bhajan. That bhajan is a ritualistic aspect of bhajan, which is powerful. So if you are not, you are doing various chores, various things, let your tongue sing a little. If you have groups of people, encourage that type of singing that elevates the mind. That's called bhajan. Subtler way, it's a mental process. You are always worshipping God. You can, Tulsidas says, you can acquire butter by churning water. Don't be surprised, you can do that. Or you can acquire oil by expressing sand particles. But you cannot cross the ocean of the world process without Hari Bhajan, without worshipful mind, without the mind worshipping God. Saas saas sumiran karo ya upai atinik. Kabira says, in every breath, you should be able to have a kind of aroma of divine worship. Literally, when you start practicing sadhana, do pranayama, when you breathe in, mentally repeat the name, mantra. Breathe out, repeat the mantra. Try to associate breath with the mantra until mantra becomes so profound, the feeling of the presence of mantra begins to emanate from your heart. So whether you know it or not, in every breath you are remembering God. Just like you are remembering yourself in every breath. That's the ideal, and we will continue next. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti.
Thank you for joining us on this journey of spiritual growth. It's an honor to learn from the wisdom of Swami Jyotirmayananda. As we part for now, remember, the quest does not end. Take time to reflect on today's insights and integrate them into your life. Until next time, stay open, stay curious, stay present. The light within you is always shining.